Morning, everyone. As you see, my name is Peter Wallenberg, Jr. I'm a proud member of the fifth generation of the Wallenberg family. I just want to say we're very happy to be here in Uppsala. During our 100-year celebration, we're actually visiting six universities and doing symposiums together with the Royal Academy of Science in six different places, and today here in Uppsala. So we're very, very happy to be here. I just want to take the opportunity to go through some things in more details around the foundations. When the foundation was founded in 1917, Knut and Alice put a very important word into the statues, a very British word that is called landsgangelit. But it means for the betterment of, and it is a word that we're actually bringing back because we feel it points to what we would like to achieve. And that is to the betterment of Sweden, society, and other things. Now, the foundation has three things that we really, really focus on. We support basic science. We are long-term in whatever we do. And we want to give freedom. A little bit as was said in the movie, we really don't mind that you fail, because we know that you will learn through the research that you have started. We will find things that we didn't even know we were looking for. And for us, that is extremely important. We have been around for 100 years. In 2016, we were allowed to give away 1.8 billion just from the Knut and Alice Wallenberg Foundation. We have some other 14 smaller foundations, so altogether, we gave away 2.1 billion Swedish kronas. We will give away just above that for 2017 too. And it is our goal to see to it that we always find ways of giving away a little bit more every year. And how do we do that? How are we capable of doing that? Oh, maybe I should say this. For Uppsala, this has meant that they have been receiving 2.9 billion since we started, and for the past 10 years, 1.5 billion. So in that sense, I think we have been helping even Uppsala in a lot of research projects. And yes, we will continue to collaborate to find other projects in the future that we can help to provide funding for. Excellent research, we will be around, I promise you that. So how are we able to get all this money to give away? When the foundation was funded or started in 1917, Knut and Alice put in 20 million Swedish kronas into the foundation. That is today about 400, 450 million Swedish kronas in today's value. Today, that is 100 billion Swedish kronas. And one can then say, how did you do that? That's a good question. No, I'm serious. We are long-term owners of large Swedish industrial companies. So it's not just that we are running foundations. We are also being long-term, very active owners of Swedish industry. So one of my jobs today is to make these companies understand that the better they do, the better dividend they can give, the better Swedish research can do. And this is important. It's something that's important for the companies too, to feel being part of this, being part of Swedish research, not only within the company, but at the universities. And as I said in the film, I think it's important to realize that we need to do this together. It's both academia, it is politicians, society, but also the companies, to see to it that a small country like Sweden find the funds to be in the forefront of research. Now, we are turning 100. And as I said, one of the things we do is to have seminars like this in important questions. And today will be interesting, very interesting, and a question that is, I would say, on most people's minds. When we put this together about a year ago almost, maybe this question was not the most important. Today, I think a lot of us, just watching the news every day, we realize that this question is becoming more and more important. So I think you will have a great, great day today. But there is one other thing that we feel is important, and that is not just to talk about 100 years of history. We're trying to see to it that we're also part of developing the next generation. And one way of doing that is through what we call a jubilee donation, where how many of you have been to Upplevelse Center in Norrköping? Good there. Now, we feel that what they have done in Norrköping is something that actually can help to promote the interest and curiosity of young people. And we feel that Norrköping is probably not the middle and the center of Sweden, which makes it difficult to see to it that as many people as possible or young people as possible can get there and get the experience. So we decided to help and build more centers of the same kind in Gothenburg, in Malmö, in Stockholm, and in Umeå. And we're also giving grants to Linköping to see to it that they can continue to develop what is being shown and how you use the Upplevelse Center or Science Center in Norrköping, and see to it that we can work together and see to it that we get the next generation to be the next group sitting in a room like this, listening to speakers like you all do today. So, as I said, I'm a proud member of the fifth generation of the family. I probably have the best job in Sweden. I'm allowed to see to it that companies do as well as possible, so they can give me as much money as possible, so I can give away as much money as possible. So you're part of that today, and Uppsala is part of that. So have a really, really good day, and we're very pleased to be here.
Okay, and then it's my job to tell you what the foundation is doing. I will start with a disclaimer. You saw the figures from Peter's presentation that this last year 2.1 billion in research is funded. But if you notice that 300 million is not coming from Knut and Alice, it's coming from the other 14 foundations. And since you already be thinking, what's in it for me, if you're in social science humanities, that's where you're going to look, because this 300 million is in social science and humanities. So we are not Riksbankens Jubileumsfond, but together with them, and we are the one of the three major sponsors of social science and humanities in Sweden. So we have three different strategies to give out money. And what I'm going to show you is a story about the gender balance of Swedish science. So notice that. When it comes to the support we give to individuals, as Peter says. This is free money. Basically, they can do whatever they want with the money in research, of course. It's projects, large projects, and strategic initiatives. We have awarded 128 projects for the first 6 years, and now we've actually taken a decision on another 18 that will be announced next week. So 128 projects, 5 billion crowns, and you see that Uppsala has received 16. The interesting thing with this figure is that if you look at Mälardalen, the Stockholm University and Uppsala, 50% of the projects have gone to Mälardalen. So remember that, 50% of this competitive research grant is in Mälardalen. This year, to award 18 projects, we had over 400 international reviewers. So we are strong believers in peer review. It goes wrong, but it's going more often right than wrong. So it doesn't matter if you try to be friendly to Peter or me or someone else. It doesn't matter at all. It's the international reviewers that you have to convince. These are the project leaders in Uppsala, the 16. Excellent scientists, but of course the gender balance is not optimal. So these are the senior levels, the most prestigious grants you can get in Sweden. Then we have individual, senior individuals, very similar to ERC advanced grants. They are called Wallenberg Scholars and Wallenberg Clinical Scholars. They get 5-year grants, you get 3 to 4 million per year, and they just have to do research. Here it looks a bit better. So four of the 16 are some of the top scientists that we have in Sweden. I'm not saying that they're better than the men on this picture, but they're extremely good. This is a pride of what we're doing. It's a Wallenberg Academy Fellows, and several of you in the audience are in this program. So this is a program where we support young people that can get up to 10 years funding from us. It's actually a unique program in the world because no one gives you the possibility to have long-term funding on this level. A couple of interesting figures around this group. We have appointed 150 so far, and we're going to appoint 300. Out of this 150, 50% are international recruits that has moved to Sweden to start their research. 40% are women. And I have a feeling that this year's fellows that will be awarded in December, we will reach 50% women. And interesting enough, 65% of this group has a foreign PhD. So it's not just that people have moved in, we have people that has come here as a postdoc and been competing. So if you think about Swedish science, where would we be without this influx of talent? At any given moment, the foundations are supporting about 1,000 scientists in Sweden. And at that, if you also include the senior ones, more than 60% have a foreign PhD. And this is absolutely essential for the development of Swedish science, that we are an international hub for science. Here you have the young ones at Uppsala, and here, 50% of the Wallenberg Academy fellows in Uppsala are females, which we, of course, think is great. We also run a number of strategic projects. We are running one in nanocellulose wood fiber. We are running one big one in autonomous systems. But the ones where it has is linked to Uppsala, it's primarily this one in life sciences. 4 or 5 years ago, it was clear that Sweden was in a deep crisis with life science. Several big pharma companies closed sites and this and that, and we were just not competing enough. At the same time, the government started the Science for Life laboratory at Stockholm and Uppsala. And in our books, 50% of the life science in Sweden is in Stockholm and Uppsala, but per definition, 50% is somewhere else. So we started the centers in molecular medicine at 4 places. At these centers, they recruit 40 new group leaders that get really good resources to move in here. And the recruitment is going great. At the same time, the SciLife Lab is appointing SciLife Fellows. So if you look at the total community that is financed by us and SciLife Lab now, it's 100 recruitments of groups to Sweden, international recruitments that come here. Every one of them start a group with 5 to 10 people. And this is happening just now. I don't think it's any place in Europe where you have that type of focused effort to bring life science back. Our contribution to SciLife Lab was to award $500 million to instrumentation. Because whatever you think, especially in physics and natural science, it is a materials game. You have to have the right equipment to compete. Finally, mathematics. We realized that people in mathematics can get money if they work on other people's previous problems, but they really can't get money to work on their own basic mathematical problems. So we, together with Royal Academy, started a program where we are financing postdocs in, postdocs out, and guest professors. It's about 35 million per year. In total, with other granting strategies, we give about 70, 75 million a year to mathematics. And with that, we are by far the major sponsor of basic math, which is, of course, say a bit of what we are doing, but it says that Sweden is not investing enough in math. In Stockholm, you have an institute Meta-Leffler, which is a world-class place where the mathematicians meet. And we have also supported the build-up. And from next year, Tobias Ekholm here from Uppsala, who is one of the international stars in mathematics, will be the director of this place. So in comparison, social science, this is not to have any comment whatsoever on the quality of science, but people in social science and mathematics are somewhat cheaper to finance than people in medicine and in physics. People in social science have never used that argument, but I think it's an argument that can be used against the politicians. So I think that's where the Wallenberg Foundations are. So even if we are a lot into the technology, medicine, and natural science, don't forget that we also are a big fan of social science and humanities. Thank you very much.